Buenas tardes a todos y bienvenidos a Joven Hidrocafé, un nuevo espacio para jóvenes investigadores en hidrogeología. Nuestra misión es dar visibilidad al trabajo de investigación que se está desarrollando en la actualidad y crear una red de investigadores junior.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Joven Hidrocafé, a new space for young researchers in hydrogeology. Our mission is to give visibility to novel research work and to create a network of junior researchers to exchange ideas and methodologies.
Yo soy Nuria Naranjo y hoy me acompaña Ana Fernández Ayuso.
As you already know, she is Nuria Naranjo and I'm Ana Fernández Ayuso.
Para todos aquellos interesados en participar, pueden escribir a nuestro correo electrónico con la propuesta que será tenida en cuenta para la segunda edición de Join Hidrocafé.
We would like to encourage young researchers interested in participating to send us an email with a proposal. This proposal will be taken into account for the second edition of Join Hidrocafé.
En el chat habilitado en YouTube pueden dejar vuestras preguntas a los conferenciantes de hoy y estas serán contestadas en directo.
In the chat enabled in YouTube, you can leave your questions to the speakers. This will be answered during the session.
Hoy emitimos la última sesión de esta primera edición y nuestra primera ponente es Yogita Dasora. Hola, Yogita.
Today we are live for the 13th time. And this will be the last session of the first edition of Join Hidrocafé. Our first speaker is Yogita Dasora. Hi, Yogita. You have to unmute the micro. The micro.
Yeah. Hello. Yes, hello. Hello, Nuria, Ana. Should I start my presentation?
No, no. First of all, I would like to make you some questions about your research, and then you can tell us.
Yeah.
So, Yogita, where are you working now?
I am working in Marvi project in Rajasthan, India, and I'm working in this project as a research fellow since 2014.
Since 2014, okay. What you are going to present today is related to your thesis?
Yes, I did my PhD in the same project two years back. I have submitted my thesis and I'm going to present some of my results from my thesis.
Great. And did you choose the topic of your thesis? Were you already interested in this kind of things that we are going to explain now?
I have been studying this project since inception, and I have started as a student volunteer, then I have joined as a researcher, and then I'm working as an employee in this project. So I think this is best thing to represent my work on this platform.
Yes, yes, you work, so, you get involved little by little on the project.
Yes.
Great. So that's all. By now you can start your presentation. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. Here is my presentation, if you can. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, perfect.
Okay, so it is
the banner, if you like.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, but I can't see other screen. I can only see.
It doesn't matter. You will only see your presentation.
Okay, sure. So this is Yogita Dasora, as you heard before. So I'm going to present today on the topic which I have done my PhD on. And this is part of my project at that time, which entitled as Evaluating the Recharge Impact of Managed Aquifer Recharge Structures Through Community Participation. So here are my details. If you would like to ask a few questions, here is my email address. And I would like to thank my supervisor, PhD supervisors, and my advisors, Dr. Bhil Maheshwari, Dr. Peter Dillon, Dr. P.K. Singh, and my colleague, Mr. Prahlad Soni, and all the volunteers and community members who have supported me in my research at the field level. So what we are going to see in this presentation when we walk through this, why we have chosen this approach, the participatory approach, what is my study area looks like and where it is situated, and how did I collect the data through community participation? And what were the methods for impact assessment of check dams or managed aquifer recharge structures using hydraulic and economic parameters? And what are the conclusions I have drawn from that study is included in this this presentation? The first question arises in everyone's mind that why community participation research? As you all know, India is a country in Asia which has made extensive use of groundwater for irrigation in hard rock areas, and that occupies around 65% of the Indian land masses. And you will be surprised that India has constructed around 5,700 major dams, large dams on major rivers. And after that, for providing the surplus water to the local farmers in hard rock areas of India, where the climatic conditions are either arid or semi-arid, they have constructed many check dams, and those numbers are around 200,000 check dams. And in Rajasthan, these numbers are not even counted yet. As you all know, in India, there is one state which is the most driest state of the country, which is Rajasthan, and it has a dependability of about 91% of drinking water and 60% of irrigation water, which is derived from the groundwater. So you can understand how important groundwater is for Rajasthan. And by constructing these sort of check dams on the small streams, not major rivers, small streams or ephemeral streams, which we can say have impacted a lot. But on the contrary side, there is only 10 studies in India which have quantified the recharge attribution by these structures. And in those 10 studies, only 18 structures were studied in detail about groundwater quantity as well as quality. As you can further study in Basharat 2018, you can find some more interesting facts about these. And these structures, you can see in the picture, there is a small bandha or aniket or check dam which checks rain water runoff from the entire area or watershed, which is contributing to this point, and then controls it up to a little bit, which is around 1 to 2 meter height, or and has good catchment properties. Can stop a runoff water and increase the detention period of runoff water. And that way it supports it provides the opportunity to recharge groundwater more and more. So this is a typical diagram of check dam. And then what are the salient features of these participatory approach? In participatory approach, what we did, we have selected few local volunteers who were ready to contribute and learn new skills like clicking photographs, collecting data from their neighborhoods, which is very nearby to their village or their houses or their farms. And then the minimum qualification is they can read and write and understand what is going on if they are provided some special trainings. And then these local groundwater volunteers, which we have called them Bhujal Jankars in Hindi, and you can say it groundwater informed in English. And these people started to collect data for water levels, rainfall, and water levels in wells nearby their farms. So why we have selected these people to collect data set, which are very important, very basic data? These are three or four reasons I have listed above, that they are accurate because they live near and they click photograph, and that photograph have date and time, and you can cross check their data, collected data with these photographs every day. The monitoring of a larger number of check dams are required at that time. As you know, we have a large amount of check dams constructed across the country, and the scientific community itself cannot go there and install expensive instruments and collect the data. So a local participatory approach is mandatory at that point. And due to use of technology, the reliability of this data is very good. And these data are robust. And these are kind of data which are best in their place. Means because in remote areas, you can't go there and install many expensive instruments and get data. So these kind of participatory approach are very cost effective. So now I'm going to show the study area where I have conducted my study. As you can see, it is western part of India. And you can see the driest state here. And at that yellow point, this is the watershed, which is around 6,000 hectares in area and has 39 first order streams, 22 second order streams, and 13 third order streams, and 1/4 order stream outside the just before outlet of the watershed. So I have selected 4 representative check dams for study, and I have applied that participatory approach to collect data of rainfall, water level in check dams, and water level in nearby wells. So if we can see that area of the Otter watershed is slightly undulating and having around 2% average slope, and we receive rainfall during June to September, and the amount of rainfall is around 660 to 665 mm per year, which is an average rainfall for what we get in that area. Then I have prepared a monitoring plan. So what we have decided, we have selected 4 check dams, and which were recorded water level on the daily basis, and we have installed rain gauges. As you can see here in this this map, that yellow dots are showing open wells which were monitored weekly near the check dams. And then we have also monitored evaporation rate at Udaipur district level monitoring, meteorological monitoring site. And because it's around 50 kilometers away from that site, so we have used evaporation data from the Udaipur station. And then these 4 check dams were studied, and their area volume elevation curves were made, and their salient features were collected. And then we have trained local people to monitor the water level every day. We have painted gauge boards, as you can see in this picture, where water level marks were painted on the gauge upstream side of the check dam. And water level falling down every day was recorded. When there was no rainfall and no spill occurring, that amount of water was assumed to be contributed to recharge. And that too, we have measured dry weather infiltration rates. It means when there is no rainfall, no water is spilling out from the check dam. And we have recorded that downward movement of water, which we have called dry weather infiltration rate. And then we have compared it to every year's performance for this check dam. And the daily rainfall record, which have helped in calculating the balance of water in each structure. And then how we have measured the check dam effectiveness. These check dams are expected to have a site-specific recharge effectiveness, as it depends of runoff and the proportion of runoff that it captures, the morphology of the area, sedimentation property, because the soil in this watershed is sandy loam, and the hydraulic conductivity of alluvium, the nature of connection between the pool water or stored water in the check dam and the aquifer, also hydraulic characteristic of that particular area and the storage capacity of the aquifer and ambient groundwater qualities. These are the parameters of the check dams which we can consider while monitoring the effectiveness of these check dams. So as I said, we have trained local people to take photographs. These are a few examples of photographs which were taken daily on the daily basis. And it's interesting that people from a village were volunteered. And initially, when they started monitoring, they were not sure what they are doing. But when they have started to collect these photographs and note down the data every day, they came to realize many things about how water is coming, what are the dynamics of water means, how rainfall is converting into runoff and reaching to their wells. So you will be surprised that I have collected more than 4,000 photos every year from July to the month of February or December, depends on every structure, the water collected for how much duration. And since 2014, I am collecting almost 4,000 photos for these four check dams. And this is providing me much more confidence in my data set. So after that, as we know, we have to calculate recharge. And as I said, we have used very basic step where we have used water balance calculation equation, where change in storage in check dam was used to fraction it into losses, storage, and outflow. So for income or inflows, we have used rainfall as an input, and then we have used decline in water levels to calculate the inflow and evaporation. And then we have separated that portion of infiltration and evaporation and outflow. And when we have subtracted the total inflow and we have removed all the losses, we have found that how much amount of water that that can be stored in each structures, and all the representative values of areas and volume captured by those check dams were calculated on daily time step in a simple Excel format calculator. And then there is one term, RI, you can see here, which is the dry weather infiltration rate. This rate is when we do not have any water incoming from the runoff into the check dam and no water is going out through the spill. So that depth of water from previous day was subtracted, and the evaporation of each day was also subtracted. The amount of water in 24 hours that is going down has considered as dry weather infiltration rate. Then we have used very crude method to find out the spill of check dam by multiplying its width and height of the check dam times 1.5. And it is a very crude method, but as you know, the amount of recharge is not very sensitive to spill. So this data can be outlined from the reliability of our results. And after that, we have found out the economics of the check dam, how the check dams are economically viable, or are they contributing what we have invested in them. So we have calculated net present values of benefits and cost, and then for around 30 years of internal rate of return was used to get the present value of check dams from the year it was constructed. And then the ratio of these present values of benefits and cost was calculated. So for after that, what we did, we have prepared the design parameters for each jag dam, the capacity, the water spread area, the total depth, the catchment area. So as you can see, there were four jag dams, and the one with the range of the catchment area ranges from 100 hectares to 1700 hectares. And as you can see, the percentage of catchment has contributed to these structures was maximum for Sundarpura, the fourth one, with around 5.77% of a total check dam area. Also, the capacity of the check dam was also converted into the mm over the catchment for getting how much water is going to reach. If there is no losses during runoff process, then maximum amount of water was captured by Sundarpura because it has highest catchment area, but capacity is second highest. So like that, in the right bottom corner, we have area volume elevation curve, which we have prepared for each year since 2014 to 2018 during my study period. And this study is also going on till now. So what we did, we have surveyed the area with the dumpy level and calculated the contours of different elevations, and then calculated the area in between and multiplied it with the depth and calculated the volumes of the check dam. As you can see in this photograph, from left to right, there is a stream coming in, and the right side photograph is showing the check dam. And this is the wall where the water retention takes place. And at the end of that wall, we have installed the one gauge board on the wall of the check dam. And we have prepared the volume elevation curves. And so that whenever we have data set for any level, we know how much amount of water is captured in the or impounded in this particular check dam. So as you can see in this graph, just shown below this photograph, it has two axes. On the x-axis, there is date from day one when the water in check dam comes in to the day where it dries up. So as mentioned earlier, in this area, monsoon onsets during July and works till September. And afterwards, the water retains up to December to February, depending upon the rainfall and runoff generated. So the captured rainfall was measured every day in the form of water level in the check dams, and then plotted against volumes. And all the volumes of the check dam water balance calculation are presented here. So you can see in green color, this is the this is showing every day water level data converted into volumes. And the yellow line is showing the cumulative evaporation every day since the day one to when the water is finished in this check dam. And the gray line, the most important line, which we have calculated from our water balance equation by subtracting all the inflows to the outflows. And this blue line, which is going high above highest in all the lines, is showing total inflow, which is accumulated for the entire season when there was water in the check dam. And this red line is a cumulative spill. And you can see that the amount of spill is less than amount of recharge, which is showing how effective this check dam is. And these four lines shows that yellow and red line, which are losses in terms of check dam for a particular check dam, where evaporation and spill are the losses, and inflow and recharge are gains. So you can see that recharge is more than twice the rate of evaporation or the amount of evaporation in the check dam. And also it is more than 1.1 times more than spill, cumulative spill. So after studying these type of graphs for each year, for each check dams, we have concluded that the check dams are recharging a good amount of water and are effective. Also, there are other ways we have used to find out that the check dams are.
Yeah. Sorry, Jogita, we don't have much more time. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Okay. But maybe maybe the speakers, maybe the audience can leave the questions anyway. At the end of the session, we will answer them. Okay? Because Jose has to speak too. I'm sorry.
So I have 5 minutes or something.
I don't think so. Okay. Sorry.
Okay, so I can minutes. Just click. If you can give me 5 minutes, I can complete here.
Okay, just try to make it in three, okay, or two.
Okay, sure. So this is my water balance summary, where rainfall, the total amount of recharge to the total inflow is 19%, and this check dams recharge about 1.66 times of total capacity. Also, this is a graph showing how this red line is showing water level in nearby wells, which is groundwater, and blue line is showing water level in check dams. So you can see in 2016, when there was a large amount of rainfall, the groundwater reached up to the bottom of the check dams. So this shows the interaction between groundwater and surface water in a visible format. And after that, the economic analysis was done for cost and maintenance cost, and it was found out that about investment of 0.51 rupees, the benefits were 0.57 rupees per meter cube, and the cost were 0.27 rupees per meter cube. So it's around four times the amount of investment. So what I can conclude from this study that after desilting, the performance of check dams can be increased, and if we increase the if we regulate the and maintain these check dams, we can increase at 8.5% of irrigated cropped areas in the area. In check dam affected area, and measuring groundwater levels adjacent to check dams can improve and measure decline in the infiltration rates, and these siltation can or hydraulic connection of with groundwater can also increase. This information can be used for better information and the site selection and design of the new check dams. Also, benefit to cost ratio suggests that it is the benefits are four times more than the cost incurred in the MAR structures, and which is good enough for sustaining and maintaining the watershed. Thank you.
Thank you, Jogita. I'm sorry, but we have limited time. Sorry.
No worries. Thank you.
Okay, so maybe Nuria can present.
Can I stop?
Yes, please stop sharing your screen.
Okay, thank you.
Muchas gracias, Jogita. Nuestro segundo ponente hoy es José Bastias Espejo, que está en Alemania. ¿Dónde estás trabajando actualmente, José?
Bueno, en el CAITE, en Karlsruhe, en Alemania.
¿Y lo que nos vas a contar hoy tiene que ver con lo que haces en tu tesis?
Sí, soy alumno de doctorado. Y bueno, sí, es parte de mi tesis, es la primera parte.
Pues cuando quieras puedes compartir.
Sí,
la
entonces
pantalla.
Comparto, esperen un poco. Sí, déjame. Vale. No.
Aquí.
Bien.
Cuando quieras.
Vale. Bueno, gracias Nuria por la introducción, por las preguntas. Mi presentación es corta, así que creo que vamos a estar bien con el tiempo. Also, a big thank to Yogita for those amazing insights, really nice results also. Y bueno, hoy les voy a hablar sobre REA, que es un simulador que desarrollamos hace un tiempo atrás acá en el CAIT para resolver problemas hidrogeomecánicos. Bueno, REA está basado en el método numérico de elementos finitos, que en principio este método está basado en una serie de rutinas numéricas en donde el usuario, es decir, nosotros, insertamos ecuaciones diferenciales parciales, que son ecuaciones que derivan de problemas físicos, de ahí que se les llame física, y que son muy difíciles o imposibles de resolver analíticamente. Como por ejemplo la ecuación de Fourier o la ecuación de Navier-Stokes. Entonces insertamos estas ecuaciones al método de elementos finitos y lo que nos entrega es una solución aproximada. Para resolver las ecuaciones se necesita tener a priori una geometría, que es en donde se van a resolver las ecuaciones, ya que normalmente estas dependen de espacio y tiempo. Este último se representa como una malla, y en la imagen, por ejemplo, en esta imagen la malla es unidimensional. Vale, entonces estos circulitos de la malla se llaman nodos, y en elementos finitos la física se acopla a los nodos. Recuerden que la física son estas ecuaciones diferenciales muy difíciles de resolver. Mientras que entre medio, lo que hay entre medio de los nodos se llama elemento. Y los elementos se acoplan los materiales. Con materiales me refiero a propiedades físicas como por ejemplo densidad, viscosidad, porosidad, etc. Y finalmente para obtener una solución en el método de elementos finitos se necesita saber las condiciones de frontera del modelo, que se conocen como, bueno, se llaman condición de frontera, que normalmente son valores conocidos. Así se puede obtener una solución aproximada a la solución real del problema. Por ejemplo, en este caso, los puntos rojos son las condiciones de frontera, que son desconocidas. La línea amarilla es la solución real y la línea discontinua es la solución del método numérico, que es aproximada. Elementos finitos también se puede extrapolar a dos dimensiones y para ello se necesita, por supuesto, una malla en dos dimensiones y saber las condiciones de frontera en dos dimensiones. El mismo caso para tres dimensiones. Bueno, después de esta corta introducción a elementos finitos, vamos a pasar al gran problema de elementos finitos, que es siempre un balance entre estos tres puntos, que es librerías numéricas, que son las rutinas en las cuales está programado el método, la flexibilidad, que muchas veces es necesario modificar la física o materiales dentro de tu simulación, y si el simulador no es flexible, esto no es posible, y qué tan intuitivo es el simulador, es decir, tiene una interfaz de usuario, es posible, hay que programar o para cambiar cosas durante simulación, etc. Bueno, nosotros creemos que REA es muy flexible, tiene muchas librerías numéricas, sin embargo no es tan intuitivo como nos gustaría, pero creemos que está casi en el centro de este balance. ¿Cómo logramos esto? Bueno, usamos MUSE. MUSE es un framework que está desarrollado por gente de Idaho, en Estados Unidos, y que originalmente se desarrolló para simular reactores nucleares. Básicamente lo que hace MUSE es conectar dos grandes librerías, que es LibMesh, que es el bloque rojo, que es una librería que incluye capacidades de malla, y ConPETSI, que es el bloque naranjo, que es una librería que incluye rutinas de elementos finitos. Entonces, lo que entrega MUSE es una interfaz de programación o API que funciona como bloques de Lego. Entonces nosotros, por otro lado, tenemos que crear nuestros bloques de Lego que corresponden a nuestra física, materiales y condiciones de frontera, mientras que MUSE se encarga internamente de acoplar estos bloques a las librerías de malla y librerías numéricas. Teniendo esto en cuenta, nosotros pensamos, bueno, ¿es posible usar MUSE para resolver ecuaciones de flujo hidrológico? Y la respuesta es sí, y para hacer eso, básicamente lo que hicimos fue definir la física, que entonces son ecuaciones hidrogeomecánicas de poroelasticidad basadas en las ecuaciones de teoría de Biot, Para los materiales hemos definido propiedades hidráulicas y mecánicas, hemos incluido diferentes tipos de condiciones de frontera como presión, desplazamiento, diferentes tipos de pozos, sources and sinks. Y finalmente hemos dicho que el resultado de la simulación tiene que ser compatible con Python para poder leer los resultados, ¿no es cierto? Y así, y a esta aplicación, bueno, todo esto, estas pequeñas rutinas le hemos llamado REA. Esto último ya tiene grandes implicancias, pero para demostrar qué tan flexible es REA, hemos diseñado REA de tal forma que es posible asignar diferentes valores de materiales a cada elemento de la malla, para así representar sistema hidrológico realista. Así, en cada elemento de la malla, con REA podemos tener un único valor de porosidad, permeabilidad, bulk moduli y shear moduli. Bueno, si esto no está tan claro hasta este punto, no importa, porque ahora voy a mostrar un ejemplo que yo creo que va a aclarar un poquito las cosas. Este es un ejemplo real, el acuífero que se muestra en la foto se llama acuífero de Herten, que está ubicado acá en el sur de Alemania y está compuesto principalmente por gravilla y arena. Gente con mucha paciencia ha estudiado este acuífero en detalle, porque es muy importante, porque fue creado por el río Rhein y es una de las principales fuentes de agua potable en el centro de Europa. Y han tomado muestras del suelo con una resolución de tan solo 5 centímetros. Y a cada muestra se le han medido las propiedades para obtener un dataset de alta resolución. Esto se ve más o menos así, con todas las propiedades, etc. Pero lo que es importante aquí es que es notar que la conductividad hidráulica varía en 6 órdenes de magnitud en muchas partes del acuífero, lo que representa un problema al momento de simular, porque cuando hay tan grandes diferencias en velocidades, en este caso 1 millón de veces más rápido que una y otra, el método numérico tiene problemas para encontrar la solución. Bueno, el problema que simulamos se llama problema Terzaghi, que básicamente las fronteras izquierdas, derechas y la de abajo están cerradas y no se desplazan, mientras que la superficie del acuífero está abierto a la atmósfera. En la superficie se aplica un estrés constante que provoca que la presión del fluido dentro del acuífero aumente. Como la presión en la superficie es menor que la del acuífero, fluido escapa del acuífero hasta encontrar el equilibrio. Vale, estos son los resultados. En este caso, esta simulación, en el lado izquierdo se ve el acuífero de Herten con las diferentes propiedades, ¿no es cierto?, física asignada a cada elemento de la malla y cómo esta influencia en el avance de la ola de presión. Y la simulación avanza hasta ecualizar la presión en el sistema. En el lado derecho se ve cómo MUS automáticamente modifica la malla de la simulación en aquellos lugares donde los gradientes de presión son muy grandes para poder encontrar una solución y así poder converger. Y, bueno, las implicaciones de este trabajo son varias y las pueden encontrar en esta publicación. También en honor al tiempo y la simplicidad de la presentación. Y bueno, mañana es feriado aquí, así que ya es tarde. No quise mostrar ecuaciones diferenciales o código, pero normalmente necesitas, para usar MUS y para usar REA, necesitas saber un poquito de C++, que es básicamente cuando se usa el API de MUS, pero para el resto solo se necesita Python. Y bueno, y si quieres saber más sobre REA, los invito a leer la publicación. Y en general, MUS es una herramienta muy poderosa donde con muy bajo nivel de código se pueden hacer simulaciones muy complicadas como la que he mostrado aquí. Así que los invito a todos a echarle un vistazo a REA y a MUS en general y si tienen alguna pregunta, MUS tiene una comunidad muy grande que siempre está dispuesta a ayudar a nuevos usuarios. Gracias.
Bueno, muchas gracias, José. A ver si alguien pregunta algo en el chat, que mientras simplemente te voy a hacer una pregunta. Tú eres ingeniero químico, ahora estás trabajando en hidrogeología, bueno, en cosas más de geomecánica, cosas así. ¿Y qué es lo que te ha parecido más challenging de esta, de este cambio?
A ver, ¿qué me ha parecido más? Sí, o sea, bueno, aprender geología me ha parecido bastante difícil, la verdad. Hay muchos. Me he dado cuenta que hay diferentes tipos de comunidades, por ejemplo, están los geólogos, 100% geólogos, están los un poco que son más aplicados, hay ingenieros ambientales, hay geoscience. Y cuando lees una publicación, de repente usan unos términos y otros científicos usan otros términos, y cuando vienes de afuera no, se te confunde todo un poco. Así que la verdad es, en eso he tenido un poco de confusión.
Bueno, es normal si cambias de sector.
Sí. Sí.
Pues por el momento no tenemos preguntas. No sé si... si van a entrar a decir, ah, mira, nos dice Carolina que entiendo que el código REA no tiene una interfaz gráfica o quizás se me haya pasado algo por alto en la presentación.
No, no tiene, no tiene. Pero bueno, sí. De ahí, el problema de la interfaz gráfica es que cuando tienes una, como por ejemplo tienen otros simuladores hidrológicos como FiFlow o como ModFlow, tienes que hacer muchos clics en orden de tener una simulación. Entonces, normalmente si quieres simular cosas rápidas, es mucho mejor no tener una interfaz gráfica. Pero sí, ahora no la tiene, yo creo que en un futuro puede que llegue a tenerla. Pero normalmente para hacer una simulación necesitas hacer todo con un script que se llama, que pones todas las funciones que quieres usar y todas las condiciones que quieres usar y tu malla, etcétera, y ahí puedes simular. Así que eso requiere un poquito de práctica, sí.
Perfecto. Pues, Ana. No te vimos.
Yes, and we have another question for Yogita, which is the following. Fromeng says to Yogita that thank you for your presentation. And has the active participation changed the local community perception of groundwater science? Is yes? If yes, how? Yogita? Hi, Yogita, do you listen to me?
I can listen to you. Yes, the
Yes.
active participation has changed their person. Yes, I can listen. Can you hear me? Yes.
Yes, but maybe there is some retard, but I can listen to you perfectly.
Yes, hello, Carolina. Yes, I can listen to you. So, yes, the active participation has changed their perception. Now they know that how much amount of rainfall can increase water level and they in their own deep dug wells, and that the amount of water captured in check dam is also affecting their water level in their wells. So they know that if the check dam is full 2 times, it means they are going to have enough water for their irrigation.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much, Yogita. I'm sorry again for interrupting you.
No,
But we didn't
it's
have time.
okay. Yeah, no, it's okay. Maybe next time I will present if I have chance
Yes, of
to.
course.
Bueno, muchas gracias, Jovita y José, por vuestras presentaciones. Ana.
Yes, sorry. Thank you, everybody, to all of you who connected to this session of Join Hello Cafe. And of course, thank you to Jose and Jovita for your presentations.
Thank you very much.
Recordaros que debajo del vídeo dejaremos el email de los ponentes para que contactéis con ellos en caso de dudas o interés. Y agradecer a todos los que se han conectado hoy a nuestra última sesión de Join Hydro Café. Y para despedirnos de esta primera sesión, nos hemos conectado todo el equipo para invitaros a participar con nosotros en la segunda edición.
So remember that under the video description, we will leave the email of the speaker so that you can contact them in case of doubt or interest. As Nuria has said, this is the last session of this first edition of Join Hydro Café. And again, we would like to thank you to all of you who have followed this session of or any of the session of this edition. And to say goodbye to this first edition, we have connected all the team that organizes and makes possible the Join Hydro Café.
Hola, buenas tardes a todos. El equipo Join Hydro Café queríamos agradeceros sobre todo a aquellos que nos habéis transmitido vuestro apoyo a esta iniciativa con emails o directamente llamándonos o haciéndonos llegar mensajes de apoyo, en concreto a la Asociación Internacional de Hidrogeólogos, a un montón de jóvenes investigadores o a hidrogeólogos de todas partes del mundo. Por supuesto, agradecer el soporte del Grupo Español y sobre todo el tiempo dedicado por todos los ponentes que han preparado y han realizado las presentaciones durante esta primera sesión. Y en concreto queríamos agradecer a las personas que nos han querido seguir en directo, que no han sido muchas, pero que sentimos que estáis ahí, hacéis preguntas en directo y os lo agradecemos muchísimo. Vamos a aprovechar el verano para organizar las sesiones de la segunda edición del Join Hydro Café. Queremos que sea que la segunda edición queremos mejorar distintos aspectos. Vamos a empezar en septiembre y una de las cosas que queremos incluir es poner subtítulos en inglés o en español, en el idioma en que no se haga la presentación. Y aprovecho para decir que si alguien de la audiencia o alguien que vea este vídeo sabe algo sobre este tema, sobre qué aplicaciones usar para poder meter los subtítulos, pues su ayuda es muy bienvenida y por favor nos pueden escribir. Para concluir, de parte de todo el equipo, muchas gracias. Esperamos veros a la vuelta de vacaciones y seguiremos compartiendo.
Yeah, so we would like to thank everyone who has supported this initiative, especially the International Association of Hydrogeologists. Young researchers and hydrogeologists from around the world, and especially the audience that followed us live. We especially thank the support of the Spanish chapter of the EIH, and especially the time from the presenters and speakers for spending time preparing the presentations. During the summer, we will organize the sessions of the second edition of the Join Hydro Café. We hope to begin in September, and we aim to improve several aspects, such as adding subtitles in English or Spanish. So any help or suggestions from the audience will be more than welcome. On behalf of the entire team, thank you very much, and we hope to see you again in the next session after the holidays to continue sharing. Thank you so much, and goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.